2021 Duel Links. I have tried to record this video so many times, and yet I always seem to go off on a ramble. I think I finally figured out how I want to do the video. Best way to do it is to literally just go through all the boxes and then just talk about events, not necessarily as they happened, but talk about if something is banned in that box, just say when it got banned, etc., etc., and just bring up what year or what month it was or something like that. Otherwise, I'm jumping all over the place and the video will literally never get done. And I think a video at this point, at least something that can come out and be watched and consumed by you guys, would be better than just sitting back and reworking the video over and over and over and over and over. I'm just gonna push it through at this point for me. I do apologize for my absence on the channel, as some people have heard on my live streams, which I live stream pretty much every day. So if you do miss my content, you can always swing by, watch the VODs on Twitch, etc., etc. I did hire an editor who has been doing a couple of videos here and there to make them a little bit more quality. So while maybe I'm not getting as many daily uploads just due to really not having anyone that wants to do the daily uploads at the time, and with holidays and everything kind of around, I do think that we do have some more quality uploads to make up for that. So I do hope that that is something that you guys can appreciate. But for me personally, I've said it on stream, my grandfather did have open heart surgery over Christmas, and my girlfriend came down with COVID. So it's been very stressful personal life that I've had for the last little couple weeks now, but everything's pretty much back to normal at this point. So I'm trying to get back into the swing of making videos. The Rye Report, Power Rankings, the new player guide help video, especially with the new anniversary stuff coming around, those are all still going to be happening. Thank you for bearing with us kind of in the rough period that we had there. But 17,000 subscribers, thank you guys so much. I love you. I appreciate you. Let's get into Duel Links in 2021. I have gone on record saying that this is probably the worst year Duel Links has experienced, and I think by the end of the video, you may also think that way. Setting up the stage, we had an outstanding ban list where Shiranui was banned, Kasaitis was banned, just the entire meta was shifted. We were playing Noble Knights, which came out that November, and Desperado. So it was pretty crazy. It was an insane meta at the time, and we just kind of have to really talk about it by just going box to box. I think that's the way to go about it. We had our first couple of Xseed boxes, but you know, in all honesty, they didn't do a whole lot. Now, while the end of the year left a lot to be desired, the beginning of the 2021 season was actually kind of insane, because getting into it, Infinite Ray, you can see here, it came out on the 31st. That would be the box that we just got a couple days ago, the equivalence. And just look at the differences in this box. Boom, Utopic Ray, boom, M7, boom, Heliopolis, straight up three bangers. Lots of good rogue decks in here as well. The Dark Tellers, the Star Seraph Scepter, this is where it started, even though it wasn't really discovered till later. This is where Star Seraph came from, Levianeer came from, Custodin came from. This really pushed Noble Knights to new rounds. Gaia Charger, which is now part of the infamous Digibug combo, came from here as well. And the entire Digibug, all the Digibugs already in here, as well as some other really good XE cards. You could really just go through this box once if you really wanted to, and you had so much good shit to show for it. It was actually kind of insane, and it left really a really promising kind of look at the game when we got this, because we were like, wow, everything's coming out, everything looks good. You know, the toxic meta is gone, we have Desperado and Noble Knight now. What's the worst that could happen? Well, we got the Blue Eyes structure deck and some support later on that made Dark Lords come back, and we'll talk about that as we get into it. But next up, another banger mini box, Photon of Galaxy. Oh my goodness, this box was so amazing when it came out. Automats got support in this box, which made them tiered almost immediately. People were playing it. Tier 1, Tier 2 deck is what people considered it. Also, all these amazing Xseed monsters. That was something we were really lacking, the amazing Xseed monsters. The Bowser, the Abyss Dweller, the Malevolent Sin. Just good for any deck. For the most part, it was insanity how much this is arguably one of the best boxes, one of two best boxes, both being mini boxes, that came with the 2021 season. It was also launched in January, end of January, a bit, one day before February. So pretty crazy support that came in here. Photons were also released, but they never had an impact, unfortunately, in 2021. But you can kind of see, yeah, I mean, to this day, we still use Malevolent Sin, Roach, Abyss Dweller. These high impact cards came in here. Mini box, again, once over, and you were good to go. I don't know if Konami started to realize at this point that they had given up too much good stuff, because Anatomic Theory came out in February, end of February, and it was lackluster. There was Mystical Space Typhoon, which was a, you know, much needed card for pretty much everybody that played competitive Yu-Gi-Oh! But Tech Genus, which is kind of the other deck in here, didn't do a whole lot on launch. It did eventually become a tier 3 deck by using the Halberd Cannon turbo build with the trap cards, pretty much right before it got nerfed, which is pretty kind of sad. It didn't really last very long, if you will. But everything else in here, Rika, everything like that, was not so good. So after the banger of the last two boxes we had, this was kind of disappointing. I had called Mystical Space Typhoon. People were asking how would they balance the game, especially when True Nade eventually got banned as well. And at the end of the day, I was like, yeah, release Mystical Space Typhoon. Cosmic is on the Limit 3 list still. Release MST. We are good to go at that point. But outside of that, Anatomic Theory, it didn't do a whole lot. A lot of people were hyped for TGs to do something, especially when the autonomy skill had come out a few days after the box, but it ultimately ended up doing nothing. But Signs of Harpies had come out, and people had high hopes for this box. It wasn't good right away. A lot of people actually failed to forget this, or remember this rather, because this was in, I believe, this is after the ban list that hit. Yeah, so this is in March, and Noble Knights at this point, yeah, they had enough of balance at this point, which is crazy. I can't imagine Harpies with balance. So we were entering kind of the Blue Eyes and the Dark Lord meta, and the next box really put the Dark Lord Blue Eyes meta over the top. But this was, people were already starting to see how good Star Seraph Scepter was. So those decks were pretty much starting to be the dominant decks. Harpy Lady themselves weren't actually that good at launch. They had to wait for Oracle, and once Oracle was around, we were deep in the Blue Eyes Dark Lord meta. Those two decks were just dashing on each other, and no other deck, not just Harpy's fault, but no other deck could take them on, pretty much, from where we were. But after they got nerfed, this deck was relevant all the way from that ban list to the end of the year, and could still potentially be relevant, which is insane. From March to December, what domination from a deck. Absolutely, absolutely crazy. Now, of course, there was other decks that rised and fell within its place, but Harpies, ever since the Dark Lords pretty much left, they stuck around, which is insane. Outside of that, nothing too crazy. Lightning Vortex, and then Hang On Mach. Hang On Mach was used in Dark Lords, and and then Dark Lords were back full-time on Ladder and KC Cup and everywhere, and they were gonna get banned, and we knew they were gonna get banned. There was no question about that, so rest in peace. From there, Eternal Stream, again, another lackluster main box, which was very disappointing. The only good things from here was the Tinky, which you needed to get because Lunalites had gotten nerfed. So if you wanted to play Lunas or any Beast Warrior deck, you had to get the Tinky. And then Excalibur, which Warrior decks like Automat, again, getting more Automat support, were able to OTK much more easily. There are some things in here, like the Full Armored Black Layer Lancer and stuff like that, but Water XCs and decks like that, they were taking a step back, and we won't see them again until the meta gets nerfed overall, which it eventually does. Moving forward, King of Vermillion, another, I'll be honest, this mini box was not very good. Everyone had hopes for tuning, for this little spell boy right here, tuning, but at the end of the day, what was most important was the Resonator's Call and the Crimson Resonator, and that's pretty much all the only good thing that ended up being in this box. The Black Armor stuff, the TG stuff, all that stuff ended up being not so good. So again, another box where one to two cards are good, and everything else is not even close to being good, and that was kind of problematic. Now people were a little bit worried, but at least we were able to get a decent deck. But the reason we got the decent deck was kind of scary. Anime skills. This is when anime skills really started to pick up and generic skills were starting to get killed off. We got the Demon's Resonance skill. You're able to fix your hand, and it was basically a copy of the Automata Pia skill. And that was a little concerning because the generic skills were about to get slaughtered as well. Balance and all those got absolutely dookied on. And, you know, as you can see now, every deck we have is anime only. So you can kind of see what happened from there. Moving forward, we got the Darkness gimmick. Oh my goodness. And this is probably the worst box we got all year. Everything sucks in here, including the gimmick puppets. They just were never good. Vampires were like low rogue tier for tournament play. They were at Worlds, I guess. Not much to say about them. Unfortunately, the best card in here was the Insector Exabeetle, which enabled the tier 0 Onomat meta, where they could go into Rhino Bus and... No one had fun in that meta. You had triple Ga-Ga-Ga head, and yeah, just nobody had fun. Crap card, Ga-Ga-Ga head, Insector Beetle, Ga-Ga-Ga head. Everyone was playing Onomatopoeia. This had come out in the June timeframe. Not cool, Konami, not cool. So yeah, probably I would, if I had to give an award for the worst box, I would probably give it to Darkness Gimmick. It straight up had a negative impact on the game, and the archetype that came out was not so good. Arts of Atlantis was an interesting one because I feel like this is what Gimmick Puppet should have been. It should have been released in a mini box. You had the Chronomalies, which had decent success, you know, again, low rogue tier, but you had really cool cards like Gorgonic Guardian, which meta decks did use. Magnets were meta this year and used Gorgonic Guardian. So I feel like a lot of these decks should have probably transitioned into kind of like these mini boxes type of things. But again, as you can see, the trend continues, 1 to 2 good cards in each box. And usually it's the expensive ones that are good, right? So that happened in August 31st. And that's when we go into Pendulum Genesis in September. Also, quick note, you can see Arts of Atlantis came out in August. Darkness Gimmick came out in June. Where's July? July is when we got the structure deck and the selection box. And yeah, that was rough. The basically double the time frame with no real content. All the content was paywalled only. There was no free to play content at that time. Duel Links essentially died over the summer, which is a real shame to see. And then it revived with the Arc 5 announcement. Getting into Arc 5, Arc 5 World Relaunch was actually pretty good. The box wasn't that great, if we're being honest, but it is a lot of stuff in here like Sky Iris that was, you know, destined to see future play, which was super awesome from them. Bloom Diva saw play right away as Melodious became a meta deck. Things like Blizzard, Evil Hero, none of this really saw play, but we're slowly over time seeing more cards like Ebon Illusion Magician get played, or Burrows came out officially for the Star Seraph, amongst other things, which was pretty cool. It was neat to see, but the box itself wasn't so good, but they had some interesting ideas. The Super Mini Selection Box, while I don't agree with selection boxes, the Super Mini was very inexpensive, and I would much rather the Super Mini replace the entire selection box system altogether. It's much cheaper, more affordable, and, you know, if you put a rare card and paywall it, at least, you know, it's like going to get a little bit more expensive of an EX structure deck. I'm down with that. I'm cool with that. The current selection box is more of a scam than the Super Mini was, even though the Super Mini had, you know, the Eccentric in there, for example. After that, we had DDD. Oh, baby, this deck was pretty sad to see. They put so much support and effort to try to make it good. It was okay at best. Harpies transition into MST, and the best thing out of it was the Clock Tower Prison. So, yeah, that's kind of unfortunate. Idea of Armageddon, yeah. Rest in peace, DDD. They got nerfed again after that as well. They're not doing anything. Chaotic Soldiers, oh man, the Book of Moon from the last year's selection box had come out. Book of Moon was what everyone was going crazy about. This is just the picture of 2021 Duel Links. It revolved around Book of Moon, and Konami knew that. They released the worst box ever. This, I said Gimmick Puppets might be the worst box. It's either that or this, depending on what your viewpoints are. Both of them had really bad decks with just a few good cards, but this one is actually just Book of Moon the box. Everything else in here is not just bad, it's bordering on unplayable. So yeah, I don't know, hard to give an award between the two. At least this one has Book of Moon, so if you're new to the game or you didn't have it before, boom, you get a really good staple card from it. But if you already had it before, then this was actually your worst box. Nothing else in here pretty much sees any play. Sometimes you see Dark Arm Dragon, sometimes you see Red Eyes Black Skull, but very, very, very rarely. We got the Force of Infinity box, which gave us the Mech Lord and the Abyss Actors. Abyss Actors actually ended up being pretty decent. They've been 4th, 5th place pretty much consistently. I've never really is broken into that top three, but it seems to be a competent enough deck for a mini box standard, which is fine. Meteor Burst has some future potential as well. Mech Lords, not so much. Santa Claus, we thought would do much, but looks like there's nothing really important for Santa Claus to hit up. You got Dino Mist in here as well, even though they're not that great. It's something to keep in mind. And finally, Fantastic Arc, which just released again, though. This is a main box. That's a lot of people are questioning, is it good? Right? And I can confidently say that it's not as good as the December box that we had earlier for 2021. This is supposed to be our box for 2022, and it's definitely not on the same power scale. There were also, again, we talked about the structure decks. Blue Eyes Evolution came out with their Blue Eyes skill. We did get a Blue Eyes skill change and the free alternative, which made Blue Eyes into that tier one deck. The structure deck itself wasn't really that good. What it did, though, was greatly reduce the cost of Blue Eyes and made it cheap. It was new player friendly, and you could actually do stump stuff with Blue Eyes. So that was pretty cool to see, having like an inexpensive tier one deck. There was the Stardust Nexus, which a lot of people played at launch. You had the new skill, Starlight Road. Junk Synchron was a shooting star right off the bat. Unfortunately, the deck never really went anywhere, but it was cool to see all the shooting stars and just the triple animation from the get-go. We had arguably the best structure deck this year was the Gaia. Gaia structure deck was really, really, really strong. Is continued to play. You can still play it in this meta today. It's more in the rogue tier category now, thanks to D-Hero. But Gaia was just super inexpensive, very, very powerful, and had access to that quick pop that was really, really, really strong. So you love to see that. We got Evil Heroes, which I'm not even going to get into. They're completely irrelevant. This is probably the worst EX structure deck in the entire game, outside of like the really, really early ones. So we don't want to talk about that. Magician's Arc came out with Arc 5 release, and you do need to pick it up if you wanted to play Pendulums that are slowly getting support over time. They're still kind of in a rough spot, but hey, we're starting to see some results, especially with Pendulum Call, which is super cool. Super cool to see. After that, DDD Apocalypse. We talked about DDD. This is just some extra support for that DDD deck. And then the Cyber Style, finally, after nerfing Cyber Dragon over and over and over, they finally took out Cyber Style. And now we have the Cyber Dragon, the new Cyber Style, Cyber Style Extreme, as long with the new structure deck to go along with it. Outside of that, memorable moments, Trunade getting banned was crazy. That was super impactful for Duel Links, because we had never seen a box SR or UR get totally forbidden. So that was gnarly to see, and kind of open the floodgates for the game, the metagame in it itself. We saw a lot more characters be useful this year. So Declan, Zuzu, all these characters, they all had anime skills, and we were entering that era of just anime skill only. So I think that's how Duel Links is just gonna be from now on. And I'm kind of mixed on that. I think there's some decks that are just not anime decks, right? And they need generic skills to be relevant. That's why I guess D-Draw is still around, but I want more options than just D-Draw. I love the concept of anime skills, don't get me wrong, but it can't be the only thing in the game. Then it just feels bad, especially when the design is lazy. KCGT, that was a meme fest. That was a very memorable time. For those that don't remember, the video is still up on this channel, but Konami did not, they did not properly, I guess, code their game or whatever. So there was a lot of issues came to the game properly loading in the skills. The TG skill didn't load in whatsoever, which was pretty funny. And then on top of that, there was huge delays. So if you were not, you know, in the Japanese time zone, you kind of got screwed. You kind of got screwed with how long you had to wait. I think after the first round, there was like a 3-4 hour wait time. Casters with me, Kamel, Mango, Moontrap, we went crazy. We went absolutely insane, you know, just staying up and just talking and filling the time until the games had come in. Ban lists were very weak. We had one recently and it didn't do anything to Harpy, so they had to hit us with a skill change on top of that, and we're not even sure if that really did anything. We'll have to wait until end of January to really see. And the reboot error recently got quote unquote fixed, except not really. It just lets you retry. Sometimes that retry doesn't go through, so not exactly exactly the greatest fix in the world, but at least you don't get booted back to the login screen. You gotta give them credit where you can get it, right? So there you go. And I really think that's about it for my review. Obviously, I focus more on the competitive side of things. You guys already know when the characters come out, the music has been really good. Declan, Gong's music, those are the two that really stick out from the Arc 5 release. Arc 5 as a world release was pretty cool to me. I thought it was pretty neat. You know, you guys already know that part of Duel Links is fine, but you can kind of see from an economic standpoint, skipping a box in the middle of the year, having a tier 0 meta this year, which doesn't really happen every year, releasing multiple toxic decks, including the return of Dark Lord was insane, mishandling of KC Cup, official events that Konami was holding, Duel Links Entertainment was streaming at the same time and getting double the viewership, and just overall this year just felt very meh from Konami. I feel like the beginning of the year was very promising. Infinite Ray all the way to Sign of Harpy, so I guess all the way from January to March, those first 3 months, I actually thought were pretty cool. And the meta that was created after that nerf wasn't the worst, with Resonators and all that, but it wasn't like fun necessarily. But then as it went on and eventually we got the tier 0 during Darkness gimmick, the game's pretty much felt pretty much bad since June. Since June, the game has just not been in a good state. And I'm hopeful that in 2022 that this will change, you know? This will change and this will include more powerful packs. They'll do a better job at balancing the game. They'll do a better job at, you know, balancing the skills. And I really hope that they take more community feedback. In terms of making the characters, the art, the music, all that, they already have that unlocked. They don't, you know? They know they're doing a good job with that. And if it wasn't clear before, you know, I love the character releases this year and I loved the personality of the characters this year. Maybe it's because I actually watched Arc 5 with you guys on Twitch as well. I was able to know what was all going on, right? So it was just cool to see for the most part. But that's pretty much it for me for my Duel Links review. If I had to give it a number, it'd be kind of hard. I would probably give this year, 2021, like a 6 out of 10. I would say the beginning of the year was really good. Halfway through the year, they really dropped the ball. And when they eventually fixed it, you know, they've had healthy metas, but the box releases have been really, really bad for the game itself. And that's kind of where we're sitting at right now. And hopefully next year really brings it back up. That's it for me. Till next time, peace out, boys. See you in 2022.